our Seaside Band. Thank you, Max. Thank you, everyone. Good morning. My name is Reverend Lori McMacken, and I will be giving you some updates on what's going on in the Inside Seaside. But first, I would like to introduce our beautiful practitioner who will be holding the light today, Gail Manishore. Thank you, Gail, for your beautiful consciousness. So today at 12:30, there is a meeting for James Van Praagh. If you would like to assist in helping out with Dr. Christian in the Emerson Room at 12:30. Now, if you would like to become a member of Seaside, we would love for you to become a member here. There is a sign-up and an application at the membership table. And today at 12:30, there will be Introduction to the Science of Mind Principles in the Quimby Room. Also, if you would like to become a new member, on March 13th, Reverend Tammy Mars and Dr. Reverend Christian Sorensen will be giving a attend a new member class. And on March 30th, if you become a new member, we are going to present you to the congregation here on the platform, and also we will take you out to lunch at the Firefly Restaurant. Now, if you are a member and you want to support a new member, we would love for you to do so. This is a good way to build relationships and to support Seaside and have a beautiful lunch at the Firefly. Please sign up at the membership table. It's $20 for yourself and for your guest. This Wednesday is the Going Within service, and I will be facilitating that service, so please join us. It is co-creating with life, and I will inspire you to have a greater vision. If you would like to take a class with Reverend Lori Sheets, it starts on March 7th at 6 o'clock, Shining Our Light, stepping into the illuminating wisdom of your soul, helps to accept what is, face your pain, and allow your authentic light to shine. On Saturday, March 19th, sponsored by the Seaside Sisters and the Earth Care Ministry, a group from Seaside will meet at our center at 8 a.m. to form a carpool. They will spend 2 to 3 hours picking ripe fruit in San Diego County, filling bins for local food banks to help the need for hungry. By harvesting the extra bounty of the San Diego County and delivering those in need, we are helping to solve the problem of hunger and waste in one sweet step. Thank you, Kelly. If you'd like to join an art class, we have an art class by Teresa Bouchon, The Art of Relaxation. Zentangle, inspire art with a splash of color. Come and have fun while relaxing, meditating with new art forms. This class begins on March 7th, a 4-week class at 6 o'clock. Please sign up in the family room. Seaside Wellness Group, sponsored by Dr. Reverend Christine Tillotson, is on Sunday, March 13th. She will be having a guest speaker, Karen Sugler, an acupuncturist and owner of Acupuncture Continuum. We'll discuss what acupuncture is and how it works. The principles used to Chinese medicine will also be presented. Youth and Family Ministry is calling for your assistance. We have the annual Easter egg hunt is coming up, and they are in need of small candies and gifts, anything that does not melt in an egg. So your donations are appreciated. Please bring them into the family room, and there will be a bin for you to put them in. Also, we will be having an Easter filling eggs on March 23rd, a Wednesday, from 4 o'clock to 6:45. And then after that, you can join the Wednesday night service with yours truly, Reverend Lori Mack. So we have International Women's Day Fire Circle Ceremony will be happening on March 8th with Kelly Holmes Sorensen. This will be in the garden at 6 o'clock. They will have a new moon solar eclipse meditation. And you'll see and hear more about this later on in the service. So Dr. Christian Sorensen has a new book called Living from the Mountaintop, Be the Mystic You Are Born to Be. And this will be two 5-week classes. And in order to get this book, you have to take the class and you get the book for free. No one else will be able to get the book. You'll be the first one. So this will be a wonderful experience for you. And I believe it's April 5th. I'm not quite sure. Just check in the family room. So Seaside, please stand and greet your neighbors and have a beautiful day. Mm-hmm.
Good morning, Seaside. Please remain standing for the congregational song. So wonderful seeing everybody here. If you're glad to be here this morning, come rain or come shine. We want you to stand up, put your hands together, and be joyful this morning. Come on.
I'm choosing heaven today. I'm choosing heaven today. I am walking the road of heaven right now. Saying I'm choosing heaven today.
I'm choosing love.
I'm choosing love today. I'm choosing love today. I am walking the road of heaven right now. Saying I'm choosing love today.
I'm choosing grace.
I'm choosing grace today. I'm choosing grace today. I am walking the road of heaven right now. Saying I'm choosing grace.
Choosing joy.
I'm choosing joy today. I'm choosing joy today. I am walking the road of heaven right now. Saying I'm choosing joy today.
Choosing heaven.
I'm choosing heaven today. I'm choosing heaven today. I am walking the road of heaven right now. Saying I'm choosing heaven.
Seaside. Nice choice you're making there. I like it. Hey, good morning, Seaside.
Good morning.
Hey, what a joy it is to be with you today. I am glad to see you have ventured through the rain and got blessed by the heavens. We have been praying for that rain a long time, so you might as well experience it to the fullest by getting out in it, and I'm glad you're here today. Your presence makes a difference about what this morning's going to be like, so I am glad you're here. I'm excited to see what happens. Centers for Spiritual Living, they are about a world that works for everybody, and in particular, around the movement today, they're talking about, I wrote it down here, but they're talking about that they believe that God is personal to everyone who can feel that indwelling presence. So it's about your personal experience. And so I'm up here with this magazine, not just because I'm going to sit back and read a magazine while they sing, but it's actually very exciting. What happened is this week, Newsweek, National Newsweek, International Newsweek, they came out with a special edition on spiritual living. And wouldn't you know, they chose the Centers for Spiritual Living to being one of the greatest educators of that. So I wanted to read to you just a paragraph in here. It's a section called Higher Education for the Higher Self. And it says that the Centers for Spiritual Living is a global organization of nearly 400 spiritual communities whose mission is to awaken humanity to its spiritual magnificence while honoring all religions and paths to God, is perhaps the most well-known institution offering spiritual education. The center's teachings are built upon the concepts introduced by Ernest Holmes in his book in 1926, The Science of Mind, which teaches practitioners the unity of all life. And then our president, Dr. John Waterhouse, said, "In our culture, people are less interested in being part of a religious organization, but they're more interested in the spiritual aspects of life and what the spiritual thing means." So there you go. We've gone national. No longer a secret. Big time. So, but with all that said, we base it all on our connection with Spirit, and we do that through prayer, we do that through meditation, and so at the beginning of every service, we just continue to take it deeper and deeper and deeper, and we have a powerful prayer today, a wonderful practitioner at Seaside who happens to be the president of our Board of Trustees, so he brings that practitioner consciousness to all the business aspect in which we do. Please join me in welcoming to the microphone to take us a little deeper, that is Rick Merica.
Please join me in the stillness. When I breathe into this stillness, I'm reminded of how close to spirit I am, for that breath is spirit, that spirit that breathes in, as, and through me at all times. Though I am never separate from spirit and all that spirit is. This energy that flows as spirit, this energy of love, this energy of caring, compassion, kindness, and also the power of all of that energy in leadership, making right decisions, taking right action. Spirit flows through all that we think, all that we are, and all that we do. I know that spirit expressing through Dr. Christian and the words that he will share with everyone today are divinely inspired. And each one of us will find something in this message today, a message that seems like and feels like it was just for us. And what I know for myself, I know for everyone here today, because everyone is as close to spirit as the breath that flows through us all, each every individual moment, through every day. And it's for this knowingness that I am so grateful. For I know that God is here and all is well.
Blessings and grace, love overflowing, joy in this place. Spirit is showing blessings and grace, mind, body, soul, and I am one with God. Blessings and grace, love overflowing, joy in this place. Spirit is showing blessings and grace, mind, body, soul, and I am one with God.
Well, thank you, Rebecca, for setting the tone. Thank you. Thank you, Max, for the accompaniment. Thank you very much. And Rick, thank you for your prayer. Thank you for setting the tone for our service today. Welcome. Welcome to you all. My name is Reverend Debbie McDonald, and it is my joy to welcome you here today to Seaside. So grateful that you came out on this beautiful Sunday. If it's your first time here, I want to extend a special welcome to you. We do have some information for you if you're new. We have a member package that we'd love for you to pick up. It's at the doors there, right as you come in the glass doors. There's a table, and inside the package, there's some information about Seaside, some information about religious science, a CD from Dr. Christian talking about our basic beliefs, and some coupons for the bookstore and muffins and some things. So please pick one up and stay and say hello after the service. We'd love to get to know you a little better. Today, Dr. Christian's talk is the 3 D's, so he'll be talking about that in a moment. But what I want to share with you is I want to share with you a video. As you heard, Tuesday is International Women's Day, and it's a wonderful day where the women are coming together to heal the planet, to come together in community. And in this time in our world, in this time on our planet, it is our women that are stepping in a very big way to awaken and be aware and be part of the healing that's taking place. So this Tuesday evening at 6 o'clock, our Seaside Sisters Women's Ministry will be having a fire circle in the garden, and we invite all the women to come join us at 6 o'clock Tuesday. But I want to show you a video. Here it is. Marv?
For ages, women have been gathering in circle to heal ourselves and heal our communities. We are at a time where the true power of the feminine is rising again. In pockets all over the world, women are gathering in circle to heal our deep wounds, share our stories, and empower each other's voices. We are the women of the earth. We are lifted by the love and sweat poured into the efforts that have brought us here. We move beyond all doubt and fear, and we have risen from the ashes and the tears. We are strong. We are stronger due to those who stood in the name of peace, despite judgment, opposition, and threat. We are wiser for the compassion shared by those who endured suffering and injustice, yet spoke of freedom and forgiveness for all. Their voices still echo in our hearts, announcing that love and equality are the most powerful threads in the fabric of human creation. We stand arm in arm with those who feel and those who see the profound potential of this new chapter in human society, where the feminine essence is valued as holy and all men and women are equally free. Mother, sister, daughter, child, we stand together. We are the sweet chorus of inspirational leaders, caregivers, and teachers who are birthing a new world. Now is the time to unify. On March 8th, International Women's Day, we invite all women to gather together in circle.
Isn't that amazing? So join your Seaside Sisters Tuesday at 6 o'clock. Together we can do anything. Just take these words within. It's time for prayer. So if you feel comfortable, go ahead and close your eyes. Just knowing and feeling and sensing that one power and that one presence, that is God, that is good, that is love, perfection, joy, and beauty. I know that source is all that there is, that there's nothing, absolutely nothing but the divine, that spirit is in, through, and as each and everything, seen and unseen, that there is only one power. And I know that I am one with this source. I know that I am one with all that is. And just as I know this is true for me, I know it's true for each one here. I know that each one is a magnificent expression of the divine, perfect, whole, and complete right now in this moment. And I know for each individual that their life is unfolding in the most magnificent way, that Spirit goes before them and makes straight any crooked place, that there's a healing, there's a growth, there's an expansion, there's an absolute flow of abundance into the life of each and every individual here. And I know for our planet that it is a time of absolute change, that it is a time of healing, it is a time of coming together. As the rains wash away any dust, I'm knowing that today is a new day. And that our women come together in the most amazing way as mothers and sisters to just change, to change the planet, to be that voice of love, the voice of source, the feminine, the divine, the goddess, knowing that it moves through each and every individual, healing and nurturing and uplifting. And I know for Seaside Center for Spiritual Living that it is a place of divine unfoldment. It is a place of expansion. It is a place of growth. It is a place of doing good on the world, in the world, in the community. That each and every individual that comes through our doors is blessed. Each and every person that serves here at Seaside is a blessing. So grateful for that law of reciprocity, knowing that as we give, we receive, and it can be no other way. It's with that sense of absolute gratitude for the perfection of it all, knowing that it is all unfolding exactly as it should be, that I just simply release these words into the divine action of the law, knowing it is so, and so it is.
Good morning, Seaside. I hope everyone's having a wonderful day. It's March. Crazy. Well, it is my honor to introduce our guest artist today. We're so grateful for her to have made her way down here from Los Angeles. And it was raining this morning all the way down here, so we're so glad for her safe travels. We hope you're moved by her music. She's actually the assistant director for the Agape Choir. And so we're really grateful that she made time to come down and see us. And she also does take time to travel and share her message elsewhere also. So we're really grateful to have her with us this morning. And like I said, if you're moved by her music, please see her after the service. She has a table set up with some music. And without further ado, please help me welcome Marianne Lewis.
Thank you. Good morning. Good morning, Seaside. It's so good to see you all this morning. So beautiful. So I am just very grateful, for this news and Newsweek that we're all here just doing the thing. We're doing it. We're awakening and lifting the planet because of it. So I'm truly, truly grateful for that. And this song is all about that transformation, renewal. It's called You Must Be Talking About the Old Me. You know, once you're on this path, you ain't gonna recognize the old me, so let's do it. Out on the bend, I bumped into a friend from long time ago. He started talking, didn't know I'd been walking down a different road. He said, I remember you, all you used to do. I know what kind of girl you are. I smiled in his eyes, kind of caught him by surprise, and said, from the truth you are so far. You must be talking about the old me that don't define me no more. I've been set free, yeah, yeah. You must be talking about the old me, just a stepping stone on my way to the throne. Mm-hmm. You must be talking about a past life. I remember those days deep in my stride. You must be talking about the old me, just a stepping stone on my way back home. Yeah, yeah. Got a call from my family last fall, all gathered around. Began to chat, unaware I hang my hat on a higher ground. Still crazy, we can see, ain't got no pot to pee. Your world is such a mess. I laughed down inside as I realized there's a truth I must confess. Oh yes, you must be talking about the old me that don't define me no more. I've been set free, yeah, yeah. You must be talking about the old me, just a stepping stone on my way to the throne. You must be talking about a past life. I remember been talking about the old me. Just a stepping stone on my way back home. Yeah, take it back. I can hardly recall events of my past. When you know they don't touch you, they never last. The madness we carry starts slipping away when you join in a new day, a new way. What you got there? Yeah. I can hardly recall events of my past. When you know they don't touch you, they never last. The madness we carry starts slipping away when you join in a new day, a new way. You must be talking about the old me that don't define me no more. I've been set free. You must be talking about the old me, just a stepping stone on my way to the throne. You must be talking about a past life. I remember the days. Ooh, I remember those days. You must be talking about the old me, just a stepping stone on my way. Just a stepping stone on my way.
That is Mary Ann Lewis. Hey, I'm fabulous. You don't look like your old self at all. Vibrant and alive, dynamic, and God expressed for sure. Thank you. Oh, how wonderful. How beautiful. My goodness, absolutely connected with Source for sure. Oh, wow, wow, wow. Okay, so this morning, let's see. I want to start with when you're on your spiritual path, you're going to be tempted not 100 times, but 1,000 times to believe in a selfhood that is separate from God, in a self that is separate than the I, the capital I, the I that I am that, I am spirit that is expressing. Life is going to continuously offer you opportunities to think that this selfhood is something different than God, that there could be something that God needs to come in and fix. And what I want us to get this morning as we take a look at our self-expression, that we're living in an abundant universe that doesn't need to overcome anything because it is the only thing there is. And so to help recognize that and realize that and manifest that in our life, this morning's writing from my book, Joyous Living, is about, or Joyous Abundance, is about the three D's of abundance, which is you've got to decide. I've got to decide, I'm going to choose this. Right? I'm going to choose this, not that. I'm going to choose this. I'm going to declare this. I'm not going to declare I'm not going to be that, but I'm going to decide what it is. I'm going to declare that, and I'm going to be disciplined enough, which means I'm going to take charge of my mind. My mind that's like a little puppy that's running all over the place. I'm going to say, sit there. You ever tried training a puppy? Does it sit there? No. It goes there. And now you put it back there, you stay, and it doesn't stay. It runs over there. And so you may be tempted to yell at that little puppy, might even whack that little, not that you would, but maybe you just a little pat on the, you don't want to do that with your mind. You don't want that puppy to be in fear of you. You want that puppy to be of love. So you keep saying, discipline. You put it back there. You put it back there. You put it back there. And this is the way you begin to bring forth that blessing that is inside of you. There is a parade of blessings and gifts that are you that want to come into this world and that you have got to decide, this is what I'm going to bring to life. This is who I am. I want you to listen to that parade of joy and happiness and decide to trust your instinct that wants to bring something greater to the party, to the situations you find yourself in, because you're the one who has to call it forth and not fall into that mind that's like a puppy that could be running all over the place, or that part that believes in a selfhood that could be separate from God and that I'm going to buy into the race consciousness of fear or constriction or whatever it may be. You've got to decide, you know what? I'm going to play here. You can count me in. I'm not going to try to fudge because nobody's paying attention. I love this story by Harold Kushner who talked about a village that on New Year's Eve, they had a big party in the village and everybody was to bring a bottle of wine and pour it into the community vat. And then at midnight, they would all share the wine. And so a few days before New Year's, people would start bringing their bottle and they would pour it into the vat and someone else would bring it. And before long, everybody in town had brought their wine and contributed to the community vat. New Year's Eve at midnight, people came up to take their glass of wine and what they got was water. And they spent the rest of the night, nobody looking at each other. Because they all knew exactly what everybody did. Nobody brought wine. They just figured everybody else was bringing wine. So I was just going to bring a little bit of water here. No one would know the better. Where in your life do you think you could fudge it a little bit because nobody's paying attention? That's not the road to abundance. Road to abundance is, hey, count me in. I've got something to bring to this party. I am a contributor to life. I am a contributor to my world. Jack Kornfield, a wonderful writer who I'm inspired by, he wrote the book After Ecstasy, The Laundry, the Path with Heart, clinical psychologist, PhD. When he graduated from Dartmouth, he took off to Asia and became a Buddhist monk. And he lived in the monasteries for years in Thailand and India and Burma. And after the years of doing that, he moved back to the U.S., to Boston, and just got a job as a cab driver. Lived in a little apartment, hooked up with a girlfriend who was a teaching fellow at Harvard. And a couple weeks, just passion, wonderful. But after a couple weeks, she started getting really frustrated with him. And it was because he could never really make a decision. It's like, what do you want for dinner? You want Chinese or Indian or Italian? He says, I don't care, it's all good. Kind of sounds spiritual on our side, right? Hey, what movie do you want to see? It doesn't matter. And after a while, she became very upset and frustrated by that. And what he realized is being this practicing Buddhist, you know, he learned to just accept whatever robes that were given to him, be grateful for whatever food that was put in his bowl. He learned equanimity. He learned acceptance. But he lost touch with his deeper self. He lost touch with his ability to make a decision. This is what I want. This is what I have decided in my life. And the true Buddhist practice is not losing all your desires. It's about being in relation, in appropriate relation, in correct relationship with those desires that are inside of you. William Blake said, those that enter heaven are not without passion. They are in a clear understanding with their passion. We're in this world. And the good side of your passions and your desires is the pleasure it brings you. The extreme side are the addictions, where all of a sudden you're trying to find, you know, something to satiate that addiction. That's too far. That's not being in right relationship. You got to decide and not be overly addicted to it, because then you become, as the Buddhist, since we're talking, Kornfield here talks about the hungry ghost. The hungry ghost cannot be satisfied. It has this little pinhole of a mouth, and it has this addiction. It wants this, and it can never be satisfied. It can never get enough food. Pinhole mouth, long neck, big belly, never enough can get down. So it's appropriate for you to decide what it is you want in your life. Amelia Earhart said, the toughest thing is deciding how to act. The rest is just tenacity. It's just sticking to it. That's the declaration. I'm going to make this declaration. This is what I'm going for. And I'm going to be disciplined enough, because as the mind begins to wander, I'm going to call it back, because I'm clear. I made a decision. I'm not at the whims of the collective consciousness or the race fear. I'm going to be a conduit through which Spirit shows up here in my life. I'm going to decree a thing that's going to be established because I'm committed to that. Or are we? It's easy to be committed to a future something, just as long as I don't have to change now. Yeah, a UCLA business professor at Anderson Business School for UCLA, Shlomo Bernadetsky, he shared a story of an experiment he did with his class. And it's about being easy to be, you know, positive, you know, about doing something in the future, just so long as you don't have to change now. They call it present bias, being present bias to the present, my gratification in the present moment. He asked the class that, you know, in a couple weeks I'll bring the snacks to class. You know, who wants bananas and who wants chocolate? 75% of the class said, I'm going healthy, bring the bananas. 2 weeks later, when the class came together, he put out enough bananas and chocolate for everybody, and 80% took the chocolate right there. You know, Give me the pleasure now, the gratification now, which is part of why we have difficulty creating abundance in our life, is because we've got these desires that want to do something now that do not support the longer decision that we have made in our life, in our world. We've got to recognize that, you know what, with God, there is nothing else. There is God. I am that which is expressing here, and that's where my security comes. That's where my abundance comes. That's where my health comes. That's where my life comes from. And I was working with somebody recently who just got approved for permanent disability. Elated. They're going to get $200 or $300 a week for the rest of their life. And they now see that as their source. And the sad part is they no longer see what it is they have as their source to bring to this world, to be sourced, to be supported. They have now committed to this as their income and their source. What happens sometimes is we get locked in thinking, this is it, this is the way. And we begin to declare, this is my source. And it begins to be real. And our discipline is supporting that in our life. And that becomes our fixation. And when things shift, there becomes anxiety. There becomes tightness. There becomes fear. There becomes worry over that. You want to experience abundance in your life. You got to be willing to decree a thing. You got to make that decision and decree it, declare it, and say, hey, this is mine to experience in life. This is what I'm going to bring to this world. And what Spirit has to show up in my life is far greater than what it is I'm thinking, but I have to give it space. Can't tell God how to do it. I just got to know Spirit's there. Old folk tale about a man who was out walking in the woods, and he saw this injured fox. Probably got caught in the chase by the huntsman, and broke its legs in its escape, and now was sitting in the bushes, just starving to death, could no longer get up to get itself food. And as he was watching this fox, he saw a grizzly bear drag its recent kill near the fox, and he ate it. And when he was done, he left the carcass for the fox and took off. And the fox just devoured that. Next day, when the guy was walking the woods again, he noticed the same thing, that the bear came with whatever its meal was and left some morsels for the fox that had devoured it then. And the next day when he's walking, he saw the same thing, and the guy got it. He said, God, I get it. If you can take care and provide for a fox, by all means, I know you can take care of me. God, I know if you can feed a hungry fox, you can feed me. I'm kind of low on faith here, so I'm going to commit myself. I'm going to sit down here and let you feed me. And he sat there all day long. Nothing happened. He sat there all day the next day, starving. Nothing happened. A third day, no food was delivered to him. He was starving. He got up so ticked off at God, said, God, I would think you would have as much love for me as you do for that fox. You take care of the fox, you won't even take care of me. I cannot believe it. And he was going into town. He sees a kid starving on the street, real angry at God. Said, God, you can feed a fox and you won't feed me. What? Why won't you help? God said, I did help. Yeah. I brought you. But you thought you were a fox. You're the bear. When you've got that gift, when you've got that something. But what happens is the mind gets fixated on something else. That's where the discipline comes. That mind that's running off like a puppy, you got to bring it back. Not beat it up and say, bam, sit. But you just lovingly bring it back and say, I meant more. I meant to be more than this. I meant to be more than the struggle, or the difficulty, or the unhappiness. I know there can be no selfhood apart from God, but I've got to come to know that. And when you know that, you can rest, because the shift happens. But you can only rest a little while, because the next thing comes along. See, that's it. That's the thousand temptations I'm talking about there. You're tempted to think that, oh no, this one is real, and then it begins to consume your mind. There was this one abundant rich guy in India who went to a master teacher and said, I want to enter heaven. Help me, help me. You know? And so the master said, I want you to go home. I want you to go home and find a room, and I want you to sit in there, and whatever you do, don't think of blackbirds, okay? Yeah, that's it. And as soon as you can stop thinking of blackbirds, you'll know God. So I don't want you to think about big flocks of blackbirds or even little flocks of blackbirds. I don't want you to think about a dozen blackbirds or even a half a dozen blackbirds or four blackbirds or two blackbirds or even one blackbird. I don't want you to think about blackbirds. And as soon as you stop thinking about blackbirds, you'll know God. We know what happened. All I could think about. What happens is our mind is so undisciplined that it runs around and believes, you know what, I can get away with pouring water in instead of contributing. Nobody's going to notice. All of a sudden, the mind starts playing games, thinking it can get by, rather than declaring and acting as if you're an abundant expression of God. I've worked with somebody whose goal was to get out of debt. Really, get out of debt. That's your goal. You know, years later, he was still working on getting out of debt because all he could think about was debt. See, what is it you're declaring in your life? How about freedom? How about creativity? How about self-expression? How about purpose? Dharma? You've got to decide, this is mine. Well, it's all good. Yeah, but you've got to decide what's your good that you've come here to share in this world. What is it? You know, it's Emerson said 150 years ago, can anybody remember a time when it wasn't hard and money wasn't scarce? Now, I don't share that with you to be a downer. I share that with you to recognize that you always had to be a contributor before it showed up in your life. Nobody's sitting on the corner, at least not back then, dishing out $200 or $300 a week. Life is reciprocal. There is an energetic match. You've got to have a level of consciousness and be a contributor, and life supports the contributors. And the more you contribute in a unique way, not necessarily your time, but the greater gift you bring, the greater reciprocation that comes back into your life and your world. It is a natural law. It's not somebody up there keeping tabs on it. It's how this works. Life responds to you, to your world. And so it's always been like that, at least 150 years ago when Emerson was around saying, you know what, it's hard. Well, people are saying that today. But it's not necessarily the truth of it. You know? It's their experience of an infinite, abundant universe in which we live, where there has always been enough. And when you begin to know that, declare that, and be disciplined enough to practice that in your life, what begins to come back into you are the blessings and the richness of life. And so you begin to say that. You say, hey, this is what I've decided I'm going to be in this world, and this is what I'm going to do, and this is what I'm going to contribute. And all of a sudden, I'm open up, show me God, and what comes are these inspirations and these revelations. And all of a sudden, what happens is I just want to, you know, the messenger, they're a little offbeat. Maybe I can get something else out of you. You know, you want to beat up the messenger because it's so out there that there's got to be something else, that I want my inspiration to be a little bit more reasonable. I want it to come with a project planner that shows me the ABC steps on how to get there. And if we have messed up along the way, I want you to get that your nature still hasn't changed. You are still that large capital I of the I am. I don't care if you yelled at that dog, or you drank too much wine, or you secretly didn't contribute to the worthy cause. We're not one of those religions that uses guilt. I wish we were. We'd have the place packed. But I trust everybody's bringing their friends back because this is an empowering, life-changing way to live. It is one that says your nature is divine, your nature is abundant, your nature is God. You have the wisdom and the allness of spirit that is moving right through you right now. You just need to step into that river of life. Napoleon Hill talks about it in his Think and Grow Rich. He talks about the big money that flows to individuals almost effortlessly like the river going downstream, bringing them good. That's what it's like. But on the flip side, there's a river that's going up that's taking people in the opposite direction, and you either have stepped into one side or the other, or have not extricated yourself from that river that is flowing up. You, with your mind, with your consciousness, get to decide at any moment which side of that river you want to be on, because it's always there. It is always flowing, because as the psalmist David said, my cup runneth over. You know? As an abundant God. You know, as in Exodus, it's talking about the Israelites being saved from slavery. And where were they going? They weren't going to the land of almost enough. Barely enough. They were going to the land of plenty. You got that? They were going to the land of plenty, where it flows milk and honey. You know? And what do? They complain about the calories with that. You know? You've got to open up because the good is there. You are the one who has got to be able to say, yes, you know, I'm going to decide, because I do have an urge inside of myself. And I have a healthy relationship with this desire to express spirit. And I'm going to declare it. I'm going to be bold enough and say, God, go ahead and use me for this. And I'm going to be disciplined enough as my mind begins to wander and think, can I get away with this? Nobody's watching. Maybe I can skimp here. You know what? I'm going to go all out. I'm going to give that a little extra, you know, because it's going to come back to me. Press down. You know what that's like? You ever make cookies? It says a cup of brown sugar. You fill it up and it's like full. But then you press it down, you get in twice as much. That cookie's so much better with twice as much brown sugar, I can assure you. Your world is twice as good with twice as much sugar, I can assure you. You know, it's true with cookies. It's true with your life. It works that way. Shaken together, pressed down, overflowing. That is what is yours. But you are the one who has to accept that in your life and in your world. You're the one who's got to know, you know, the story of Jesus has come that you might have life and that you might have it more abundantly. That's right. That is the purpose of life, that you can have it more abundantly. I'll tell you what, it is about bringing forth that presence in this world. Spirit or life or call it what you want is so much more pleased when you got it going on and it's working in your world. Doesn't have to worry about you having problems. I know if I were to take Trevor to somebody's house and he showed up all disheveled and holes in his pants and his hair messed up, besides mom being upset with dad, what kind of reflection would that have on his dad to let him look like that? What kind of reflection is it on life to have you struggle in this world? You're the one who's got to decide it's okay to be a divine expression. You can do so much more for life when you are a positive expression. You know, well, Christian, it's just, I don't know how I'm going to do that. I'm going to tell you a story. I may have shared this a couple years ago, but I like it. It's about Theodore Johnson. I don't know if you remember this, but here's a guy in 1924. He started with this, never worked before. He started with this new upstart company called United Postal Service. And he worked there all of his life. That's what he did. He never made more than $14,000 a year. The highest he ever got was like managed personnel a little bit. But he did have a plan. So he decided that this is how much I need to be able to take care of my family later on in life. So I'm going to put 20% away. And that's what he did. He consistently, every check he got, bonus, whatever, 20% away. And through compound interest, through splitting of stocks, through whatever, he got later in life and he was comfortable. And at the age of 90, when he divvied up his estate, it was worth $70 million. Just by being consistent in honoring what he had decided, being disciplined with that, and declaring this is what it is I need. He was able to take more than $35 million of that and give it to educational causes. In 1940, he had a hearing loss, and so 10% of it he went to the deaf community for education. He gave another chunk to UPS to support the children's education of their employees. Imagine the joy this guy had, and he had nothing. He didn't have the education. He just stayed consistent with what he had declared. He decided, and he was disciplined in his practice. That is what happens. Or you know the story of Sir John Templeton. I love that guy because growing up, that was the only individual philanthropist who gave to spiritual organizations. His story was that, you know, he dropped out of school at eighth grade, he struggled. And in 1939, when Germany declared war on Poland and the stock market in the world and everything crashed, his belief is you can't make money when things are in a bull market and things are growing and you put a house on the market and people are bidding against each other and the house sells at the high price. You got to wait till usually when things are down before you can do it. And so what he did in 39 is he scraped as much money, $10,000 as he could get, and he bought 100 shares of every stock on the New York Stock Exchange that was below a dollar a share and went on to be a billionaire. So I'm sharing that because bad times, consistent times, old. Here's a young one. I love sharing these stories. Here's someone who had an idea. You know, it's not caught up in the race consciousness. I have this idea. Do you know the story of Marley Diaz? She's this 11-year-old African-American in New Jersey. who had been reading the school books. He said, "Mom, all these books are about little white boys and dogs. There's no stories about anybody like me." And I love what her mom said. This is great. This is what you can say to yourself. This is what you can say to your kids, to your grandkids. She said, "So what are you going to do about it?" Got that? What are you going to do about it? There's a video clip came out earlier this year on CBS This Morning Show. Marv?
Characters you loved as a kid look like you. A research library at the University of Wisconsin, found that of the 3,500 children's books it received last year, only 261 were about black people, and just 100 came from black authors. One New Jersey sixth grader isn't satisfied with numbers like that, so she showed Benita Nair how she created a new chapter.
I am bored on a Tuesday at University Hospital, Columbus, Ohio, USA.
For 11-year-old Marley Diaz, a good book opens the world.
You always have words. You're able to express your emotions when you read.
The people who look like me keep fighting.
But there are some books she's assigned in school she's grown tired of.
The books were just mainly about white boys and dogs.
I read Shiloh, Shiloh 1, Shiloh 2, Shiloh 3, Where the Red Fern Grows, and a bunch of other ones. I'm sick of it.
Marley wanted books she could relate to, with characters like her.
So I just went to my mom, and then she told me, "Well, what are you going to do about it?" And that's kind of how the book drive started.
The idea was simple but ambitious, to collect 1,000 books about black girls.
And we started posting pictures on Instagram of me holding black girl books and pretending to read them. And then we added the hashtag, and now it's become a full-on book drive.
How did you come up with the hashtag?
Well, we know that social media is like the main outlet for us to get anything that we want now, so it needed to be fun, catchy, and just something easy to remember. So we wanted 1,000 books, and we wanted them to be black girls, so you just kind of snag them together, and you've got a hashtag.
Were you ever nervous that you wouldn't be able to find 1,000 books about?
100%.
But that nervousness has been replaced with excitement. First, local media got wind of her drive.
So please welcome Marley Diaz, everybody.
That led to appearances with Larry Wilmore on The Nightly Show.
And your name is Marley. That's such a good name. Were you named after Bob Marley?
Yes, my mother is Jamaican, so she named me after Bob Marley. I have to do my homework so during your show time, but I'll always be on YouTube watching your videos.
And with Ellen DeGeneres.
You need to figure out your priorities, because it should be my show, then homework, but that's all right.
So did you guys just decide to start putting them on the floor?
Yeah, it's kind of easier to organize them.
The books began arriving and stacking up. When we visited, Marley had collected close to 1,300 of them.
Do you have a favorite book?
There you go. So I don't want to hear you're too young. 11 years old, she had an idea, she decided. She declared it, and she was disciplined. And last month, she took 1,000 books to her mother's hometown in Jamaica. That is what is possible. But you see, she wasn't saying, "Woe is me." Someone said, "So what are you going to do about it? You got an issue in your life? Don't buy into a selfhood that is different than God. Know that with God, all things are possible, and you are the I, the capital I of the I am that, which is expressing in your life." And so you've got to begin to embrace the idea, the abundant idea of your greater good, and not try to figure out ways in which you can skimp or get away without being caught doing something less than the greatness of who you are. You have been called to be an expression of the divine. You've been called to share what it is you've got. And if you don't feel there's enough, you can still be appreciative for what you have got, because all those that are in that a wonderful flow of that river of life, all those that are in that affluent place, live with a sense of gratitude. A sense of gratitude for what it is they have, for what is coming, and how blessed their life has been. But I want you to get that they didn't start that gratitude after they got somewhere. They began to embrace that sense of gratitude before the good ever began to show up. So you can begin appreciative for the good and the abundance that you are now, right where you are in your life, because you are surrounded. If you stop to pay attention, you'll recognize how your world is surrounded by so many blessings and so much good. There is no way in the world you could pay that back. My mind is boggled how many blessings come into Seaside consistently. I wake up every day with a sense of gratitude for my relationship with Callie and Trevor, for being here at Seaside, and for all of you who are in my life. I'm filled with this gratitude because there's no way I can do something to reciprocate that back to each and every one of you. But you know what? I've come to recognize it's living in gratitude and appreciation is what we can do to add the blessings to this world and to keep that good circulating. I want to share with you this quote from Elizabeth Gilbert that I just came across this week. And she's the one who wrote Pray, Eat, Love, or Love, Pray. Yeah, that's it. She wrote that one. But I love this line about gratitude. She said, maybe we must all give up trying to pay back the people in this world who sustain our lives. In the end, maybe it's wiser to surrender before the miraculous scope of human generosity and to just keep saying thank you forever and sincerely for as long as we have voices. That's what I'm committed to. Just keep saying thank you. Looking out and seeing the Spirit of God. Not trying to get out of debt, but to be grateful for the abundance that is flowing in my life. Not to try to figure out how do I get out of struggle, but to be grateful for the freedom that I have to be able to choose with a mind that is free enough and not bound to the ways of this world. I am grateful in a place of question to know that there's something inside of me that knows how to decide, and that if it gets on the addictive side of things, that I can, through right relationship with that desire, bring it to a place of balance and acceptance in my world and not give my power away to anything outside, because there is not God and something else. So when somebody calls me, a client calls me, or a headline grabs me, or a prayer request comes in, I don't try to overcome it with something greater, because it's not about trying to overcome that. It is about going back into my right relationship with that presence of God, with that life force, and recognize that there's no selfhood opposite or opposed to God. And so as I go into that place of that divine consciousness, there is no room for God and a problem, no room for God and an issue or the difficulty. There is God expressing the answers and the wholeness in ways that are moving through me as I decide this is the way I need to act. Not, God, why aren't you providing? God provides and brought you into this world as a bear, as a lion, as a tiger, as a deliverer, as something great and grand, not to lick your wounds and go, whoa, give me $200 a week or some food for dinner. You are here because you've been given a purpose. You've been promised. I love this promise. I'll end with this promise from Deuteronomy 1st chapter, verse 11. It said, may the Lord God of our fathers bless you and prosper you 1,000 times more than you are. But you've got to decide that it's yours. God bless you as you do. Look forward to it. Hey, let's keep going as we bring Mary Ann back to our stage.
So blessed. Thank you. Thank you. Grateful. Grateful. Great thou art, how great thou art.
From a lofty mountain grandeur, and hear the brook and feel the gentle breeze. Then
good one. I like that. I like that. Man, those high notes. You're way up there in those celestial realms. So, well, hey, this is the time of our service where we have the opportunity to unite together in the givingness and the sharing of that which has blessed our world and our life, and know that as we give, that's what comes back to us, pressed down and running over. It's the level in which we have chosen to participate in life. You get to become the activity of spirit in your world. You cannot outgive God. Try it. We'd appreciate it. And but so would you. You would find that your world will increase in ways that are right and relevant and significant and real for you. It shows up in those areas of concern for you because spirit shows up across the board. That's why you show the appreciation where you can, because the blessings ripple across the full spectrum of life, because God is everywhere. It's omnipresent. And so what you want to be is that divine expression. So with that, I want to invite our ushers to come forward as we do take this gift from our heart and our soul, and know that which has blessed us is our joy to continue to share that blessing. I want to thank those that mail in your contribution when you can't be here on a Sunday, or those that remember us with the auto tithe, that regular systematic support from your world into Seaside's. It's greatly appreciated on that regular basis because we got the regular obligations to keep moving through this time and space in this world with those financial obligations. So it's appreciated. Thank you to those at home that are watching us live streaming. We know that you are there. We appreciate you. Thank you for sending in your gifts. It is felt, and it allows us to keep sharing this with you on this regular basis. We love you. And with that, I invite all of us to join together in consciousness and heart and soul as I share this prayer of appreciation with the most generous of spiritual communities, knowing that this truly is a blessed moment of a recognition of that which is truly the source of all things. For that which moves through our life is that divine energy, that God expression. And with that movement comes the enrichment, the enlivenment, the revitalization, the clarity, the strength, and the well-being of being able to know that the source is spirit, and that source continues to show up in our life in those times that it is needed. because it is always there. It will deliver the food when the food is needed and will give us the strength for the time we choose to be that bear. For truly the blessings, the Spirit supports itself as you in a healthy, abundant kind of way. So that which has blessed our life, we take and we share this in the world. And so we send this forth into life, knowing that it continues to bring the blessings and the grace and the good to everyone. Thank you, Father, Mother, God, for this opportunity to just remember the source of all good. And so it is. Amen. And together, let us say this affirmation of abundance, which is, Spirit continues to bless my world. Gratefully, I live as the giving expression of Spirit, opening the floodgates of the affluent flow of greater good as my life now. Are you guys from Seaside blessing us week after week? And I stand before this blessing and I can feel the love that's outpoured through each and every one of our hearts and souls, and I'm filled with a sense of gratitude and appreciation for that support, knowing that together we have created a powerful expression of God, and know that Seaside continues to be a radiant light, a holy ground, a divine vortex where those that can come and feel that presence, that enter this campus, can feel that divine movement of God itself. For truly, Seaside is a blessed place because each and every one of us is part of making it real and alive and what it is. So I stand here with this blessing and just know that this wellspring of good that has moved through each and every one of us continues to bring with it a greater expression of the true source into our individual lives in ways that are just right and real and perfect. I say thank you, Father, Mother, God, for this opportunity to share this blessing, and I know that the blessing is received here at Seaside and handled in good stewardship and sent forth back into life into that wonderful stream that brings it greater blessings to all it comes in contact. Thank you, thank you, thank you, not to anyone, just like a thank you, Father, Mother, God, to life itself. For being a part of the divine flow. And so it is. Amen. Hey, this is Richard Drutman. He is one of your Board of Trustees members here. I think treasurer now, right? Yeah. And treasurer. So you take good care of that. Mary Ann, what a joy always to have you come down to Seaside. You're like an angel that has arrived among us. So bless you for the love you share. Rebecca, you're just a joyous expression, an angel yourself. We are grateful that you are here every week with us. Rev Deb, just thank you for sharing your love and the blessings you bring us. And Wednesday nights, if you want more Debbie, Wednesday nights, though this Wednesday is Reverend Lori Mack, right? So, hey, giving us sound today is Matthew. Thank you very much, Matthew. Giving us the visuals is Marv. Thank you very much, Marv. Know that there are CDs available right after the service if you'd like to pick one up. And Timothy, who is behind that camera week after week for 10 straight years, we appreciate, we love you, and thank you for sharing this for the world. And so if you want to just listen to this, you can listen to joyouspodcast.com, and you can hear the Sunday service. Or if you want to watch the full service, if you didn't catch it all on your camera, you can just go to our website, and you'll have this camera shot of the whole thing to share with you or your friends and say, you got to listen to this. It will change your life. And if you like it so much, you come out here for Easter. Everybody's planning to be here for Easter, right? We've got 3 services, 6, 9, and 11. And bring at least 2 friends because it will be packed at sunrise, 9 and 11 for sure. Hey, there's a lot going on here at Seaside. We're getting together after the service to plan the Von Prague event that's coming. The tickets are already selling, and we haven't even put them up for sale yet, and they're selling because I guess we do have it up online. We'll start next week. Let's see, Monday night, Reverend Lori Sheets is starting a class about shining your light. We've got an art class that is going on. Then you heard Tuesday night, the Seaside Sisters are coming together. There is an eclipse going on that night, so they're just celebrating the Women's International Day that is happening. Then, let's see, next weekend, we're doing a crop share. So what we're doing is we're gathering here, and we're going out in the community of San Diego, and the citrus trees, we're picking fruit, or maybe avocados too, I don't know. But just locally, we're gleaning the extra fruit that wasn't picked, and we're putting them in food baskets. So if you want to participate on that, the information's on the inside of your program. But it's just being like socially active in our own town. It's getting our hands off our campus. So that's going on Sunday, daylight savings. So, spring forward. You know, if you don't, it's okay. You'll show up in time for the collection. But, I'd like you to get the message too. So there are and Sunday night we got a young adult service that is happening here. There is a group of the next generation that's going around to different centers, and every second Sunday of the month, here at 5 o'clock, young adults are doing a service. Not five, not six, five. Five. Okay, so be here. Hey guys, anybody want to share anything? Anything from the youth program?
They're shy today.
Well, the rain will do that. You know, you're just helping you grow. So, but Jackson, I'd love to hear from you next week. Okay. All right. Well, what do you want to show? Nice. Okay. Very good. Waffle. That makes me hungry. I haven't eaten all morning. Actually, I haven't eaten since last night. That looks really good. Red waffles, raspberries. I can keep going on. There's so much good, but it's time to pray. You know, all this leads to this moment. The laughter, the fun, the heart, the soul, the spirit, the stories. It leads to this moment because our movement is about the results that show up in our life. And we do that through prayer. And that's what we do at this moment of our service. So I want to invite any of our religious science practitioners that are present to stand. And just all of us to feel this upliftment of that divine vibration. For I know right now that it is right to live in this world with an ease and a grace. For that divine expression of spirit is moving through you, through me. For there's only one life, that is God life. That life is perfect as my life now. It is the wisdom that guides the universe. It's the same intelligence that is working within our individual world. For there is no separation. There is no self apart from the divine. I am that I am. I am spirit expressing. And though I may be tempted 100 times or 1,000 times to believe in a self separate from the divine, I come back into this alignment. And it is in this alignment the problems, the constriction, the pain, the challenges cannot remain. They're not part of that spirit. And so in this moment, I choose to allow it to be that easy. I don't need to do battle. I don't need to smack that puppy mind of mine that wants to go over here. I just lovingly remember spirit. Spirit. And so as anything comes to mind in your life, in this moment, it appears to be not spirit, like pain, dis-ease, argument, constriction, you can label it what you want. I'm not going to attempt to overcome it like trying to get out of debt. I'm choosing in this moment to invite all of us to just look to that light, to that vibration of spirit, and know that it's in this place all things are possible. But that possibility shows up through you. You become that divine conduit of its expression, and you must have the courage to decide and decree and declare that which is yours to do in this moment in life. It's not like any movie will do. No. I know right now that this divine expression that's coming through me is expressing in this way in my life, and that I have the courage and the conviction to take that step that is necessary. And as I do, I step into that affluent stream of life that all those that live in affluent flow know, that Spirit moves like just downstream with this abundant good into our individual lives in those ways that are real, right, and relevant. We begin to walk in this world with a greater sense of confidence and competence. For the divine has its way right now in my world, in my field of awareness, and what I know, for I have received that call, whether it's from the headline or the internet or from the client. All I ever need to know is the fullness of God, that I am that and is in that place, that anything else begins to fade into the nothingness from which it came. So healing happens, not because I say so, but because wholeness is already so. Every prayer in our prayer request chest is so. Surround Lee Cortez at this time in her life with a love as she prepares to step onto the other side, knowing that she knows exactly how that's done, for it's just as natural to leave as it is to arrive. Nature takes care of that. And the family is surrounded by love and strength. And I know right now that the blessings of Spirit continues to unfold in our personal experience and in this spiritual community, because Seaside continues to grow, it continues to thrive, it continues to share that light ever brighter and be a more significant contributor to the collective consciousness of this community, of this state, and of this nation. For the blessings of Spirit moves in this moment, uplifting and enriching everyone who ever chooses to tap into that space, for it always is. I'm grateful, just grateful. And it's in this sense of gratitude, a sincere gratitude for the good, the healing happens. Not, because it's not my will, it's thy will. It's an expression, it's light, it is life that is happening now. So I let go to this. I let go to the law, to the life, to the motion, to the wholeness, to the perfection that is already so. And do that for which I'm called to do. And so it is. Amen.
There was a time in my life I thought I had to do it all for myself. I didn't know the grace of God was sufficient. I didn't know the love of God was at hand. But now I can say, if you are discouraged, struggling just to make it through another day, you've got to let go. And this is what you have to say. Come on, Seaside. I release and I let go. I let the Spirit run my life, and my heart is open wide. I'm only here for God. So no more struggle, no more strife. With my faith I see the light. I am free in the Spirit. Yes, I'm only here for God. Said I Seaside.
And our affirmation is, I declare my abundance now. Together, I declare my abundance now. Touch your heart and say it again. I declare my abundance now. One more time like you mean it and it's true. I declare my abundance now. In our song of grace.
I'm living my life for what I believe, through joys and through fears. In this world I walk, God's grace shines on me and it shines on us all. We are living in grace. We are living in grace. We are living in grace. United we stand as one family. We are